Hi folks, it's Shane here at I Like Bushcraft again. I've recently had a request asking me how I set up my hammock and tarp. So if you're not sure how to do that, or you're thinking of buying a hammock and tarp to use, or you've just brought one and you're a little bit unsure, then in this video I'm going to give a step-by-step detailed demonstration of how to do that. So stay tuned. I've recently had a request asking me if I could give a step-by-step demonstration of how I hang a hammock and tarp. So if you've bought a tarp and hammock set up, or you're thinking of buying one and you're not quite sure as how to suspend them, how to use them, then I'm going to go give a step-by-step demonstration on how to do that. Okay, so first of all, we take our tarp out of its stuff sack, and in this case I'm using a DD 3x3 multi-can. I do like the DD tarps, very durable and robust, and really good value for money. That's been my experience in any case. But you'll notice halfway, if you divide your tarp in half, you'll see that these ridge loops. So what you want to do first is just take the middle three ridge loops, the end ridge loops, the one at each end. We don't need those at the moment. We're not going to use those for the moment. We just want these middle three, and those are the three loops that we're going to put our paracord, in this case I'm using paracord, ridge line through. So we'll do that first, and then we're just going to thread that through our middle three intermediary loops to begin with, like so. So now that we've threaded the ridge line through our three intermediary loops on the tarp, what we do then is take one end of the ridge line and wrap it round our tree, and then tie our first knot. And I'll bring you in close so I can show you the knot that I use for that. And again, it's a quick release knot. So I'll bring you in and show you that. So there we are. We have the ridge line around the tree. And as you can see, I've got the tail end in my palm and the main ridge line in my palm. Then what we do is we take this tail and bring it once round our hand, like so. Okay, still holding the main ridge line, and we probably need to use this other hand to hold this part as well now. And then we twist our hand up and over to make a loop, and then bring the other part of the ridge line through the loop, like so. Okay, you see that, and then bring the tail end through the loop that we've just made, and then pull tight, and then that pulls tight up against the tree. And that's our first knot. I'll show you again. Over, twist,
pull the ridge line through like so. You make that loop, and then with a tag end, pull that through the loop, just holding it as a loop through the other loop. Pull it tight, and then just slide to the tree, and there we go. And that's our first knot. And again, when you pack up in the morning or whenever, all you do is just pull that, and there we go, quick release knot. So that's the first knot we tie to our first end of the ridgeline.
Next, we take the other end of our ridgeline and attach it to our second tree. So firstly, we bring our ridgeline around the tree and pull the ridgeline as tight as you can, okay? And then we bring the ridgeline bring the tag once over the main ridgeline, like so, and then pull taut and then round the tree again, like so. And that really does give you a really taut ridgeline. So I'll just show you that again. So again, put the ridgeline around the tree, pull it as taut as you can, okay, and then underneath, pull the tag underneath the main ridgeline over the top, and then pull in tightly, bring it back round the tree for a second go, and that gives you a tight ridgeline. Now I'll show you the securing knot. So we bring our tag end over the top of the ridgeline, like so, two fingers through, pull the tag through, like so, create a little loop, and then with the tag, another little loop through that loop, and pull tight. And again, if you want to, you can actually put another loop through that loop, and pull tight. And there we go. And that is secure, that will not come undone. And then again in the morning, quick release, just pull it all, and there we go. Good to go. So I'll show you again. So there we are, we've put our ridge line around the tree and pull as tight as you can. Bring the tag underneath the main ridge line over the top, pull it taut. There we go. And around the tree again, like so. I'll just adjust the camera for you. And then underneath, two fingers through, pull the loop through, bring the loop like so, and then this tag end, another loop through that loop, and then just pull it tightly together, and there we go. And that is secure. And again, like I say, you can make another loop, put it through that loop, and that's our ridgeline. So that's the first thing we do.
So you can see that we've got our ridgeline attached to our tree, our two trees. And as for spacing, I normally space 4 good paces and a half to get the approximate distance between trees. So if you kind of pace out 1, 2, 3, 4 and a half paces, that normally works out around about right. Again, these knots I use, they're the knots that I always use, and they've never let me down yet. The next thing we want to do is, once we've strung our ridge line, is we want to tie some prussic loops and attach those to our ridge line. And once we've attached these, they can just stay permanently on the ridge line, ready for use time and time over. So I'll show you how to do that now. So for the prussic loops that I use, I find that kite string, you know, the twine that you get from kites, or the kite handles. The reason I use that is because it's tough and durable, but also it's a lot thinner than the main paracord. Apparently prussic loops have better grip if you use a thinner cordage than your actual main cordage. So, and then once I've cut a piece of around about a foot or so, it's just a simple overhand knot in both ends. one loop. Simple as that. Okay, and then we'll attach that to our ridge line.
Okay, so there's our ridge line and there's our prussic loop we've tied. So put it around the main ridge line and then take this end of the loop. Imagine you're dividing it in half. It's half the loop, this side of the line, half that side, like so. And then take this inside that loop. Once, twice, three times. And you can if you want four, but I find with this thinner stuff, three times is plenty. And then just pull it taut. And as you do so, try and keep these loops, these bindings around the main ridge line in order and tidy. If they're overlapping, it tends to snag sometimes. And then there we go, pull it a little bit tighter. And there's our prussic loop, which will slide up and down the line, like so. But then when you put tension on it, like so, it will not move. And that's what holds our ridge of the tarp taut. And again, so we put one on one end of the ridge line and another one of these prussic loops, same, exactly the same method, on the other end of the ridge line as well. Okay, so now with our ridge line attached and our prussic loops attached to our ridge line, what we need to do now is just cut ourselves two toggles. I tend to use just under pinky size thickness. Pinky size is okay, you know, thickness, and probably about 2-3 inches long. They want to be not rotten wood, they want to be quite substantial. I normally use green wood, but in this instance this is dead standing and it's more than strong enough. Then we use those to tauten or tighten the ridge of our tarp to our ridge line. So we do that now. So here you can see our three intermediary loops hanging on the ridge line. Now what we do is we take the end securing loop of our tarp, and that's the one we're going to secure to our prussic loop with our toggle. So I'll just get the toggle and I'll show you how we do that. So there we are, there's the end loop of our tarp. And what we do first is we take our prussic loop and pass it through this loop of the tarp, like so. Then we open up the loop of the prussic loop and pass this end of it through the middle, so we have that. And then we use our toggle through that loop and then pull it tight, like so. And that will secure this end of the tarp. And again, we do the same the other end. So we do that now. Now, as you can see, our tarp is a little bit off center. It's more to this end of the tree than it is that end. And obviously we want it central so that our hammock hangs in a nice balanced fashion. But that's not a problem. All we need to do is loosen one of the prussics, slide it along, and then reattach the other one, the other end, and then we can centralize it. I'll just demonstrate that for you. So if we just slide this along. Take our toggle out. And then slide this one further along this way. Come back to this end, slide this prusset towards our tarp loop, insert our toggle again, and there we are, easy peasy. Now you might be wondering, why has he not run the main ridge line through the end tarp loop? There is a reason for that, and I'll demonstrate that now. If you've not seen the video on how to achieve a better tarp hang,
that I've made, which explains that in more detail. But I'll run you through it as well quickly, so you can see the difference that it does make. So just to finish off the tarp hang, what we need to do is take some reasonably strong dead standing, green will do as well, green wood. And by that I mean wood that's still alive. Normally around about 4 finger thickness. And then what we do is we cut a V or a notch in this end. So if I just demonstrate that. So as you can see, we cut it in an angle that way, and then turn the stick over, and the same from the other side, being careful of your fingers, of course. There we are. And there you can see there's that notch in the end. And then we do the same the other end. We want to cut these, I'll say, around about 6-7 inches. And when we cut these notches, try and cut the wood so that they are in line. Okay, so we do that one. In towards the middle, the centre, turn the wood, and then same the other side. And again, there we go. So we have our notches either end. And we need 2 of these. So that's one, we'll just cut another.
So we have our two spacers, and what we do now is we just break that out of the way. That's another thing you have to be aware of, is the old eye pokers. So what we do is we just loosen our prussic loop, just slightly, not too much, and then we insert the notch of the stick, or we place it, I should say, not insert it, place it on the edge of the tarp loop, and then pull up our main ridge line.
Really?
Again, look at that side. So there we are, it's on the tarp loop, but you can see the reason for the notch now, because the tarp loop will sit nicely in there. And then stretch up our ridge line, and then that goes in the other notch, like so. There we are. And we can just straighten that up, and you can see what that does. Do the same the other end.
Now the reason for putting these stays in, as you can see, is our ridge line and our intermediary loops are a lot tauter, and there's no sag in the ridge of the tarp. It's a much better, neater hang, and that's the reason for this. And that's the reason that I come up with the idea and implement it, because I just prefer the tautness in the ridge. I find the water will run off better, and there's less chance of puddling in heavy rain.
So all that's left to do with the tarp is just cut some stakes or some pegs, wooden pegs, and then just peg the tarp out. So we'll do that now.
Sharpen the edges. There we go. I use about 1 foot long. I normally find that way, if I make them about that length, I can put them at a nice angle. If you put your pegs in too upright, the guy ropes could slip off in a heavy wind, so I tend to put them in at a good angle, which is why I have them a bit longer. So we'll put those in, peg the tarp out. Now you may or may not have noticed that my guy lines on my tarp are all hanked nice and neat. The reason for this, of course, is that when you take your tarp out to use, your guy ropes are not in a tangle, and you can get the tarp up as quickly as possible, which is useful particularly if it's raining heavily. And if you're not sure how to do this, I'll just run you through it quickly so that you know for yourself, so you can use it on your own tarps and guy lines. You'll see I just pull that and you can see how easily that came undone. So I'll show you how to do it. So we start at the tarp corner of our guy line, and what we do is we're doing a figure of eight between our thumb and our pinky. So it's once round a pinky, round the thumb, figure of eight round the pinky, round the thumb, and so forth. Okay, and then what you need to do is you need to leave yourself a good couple of feet of tag end of the end of the guy. And then what we do is we take that, like so, and then with the tag end, this tag end, is we wrap it round and to bind these figure of eight loops. But the first loop we tie around, then the second time we go over the top of that first loop, then we can start binding down our guy line, the figure of eights. And you can do this as much as you want. Okay, and then again, the last few turns, again, leave yourself about a foot of tag now, and then round the fingers three times, pull the loop through, like so, and then pull tight. And there we go, one hank guy line. So as you can see, I like to put the stakes in at a good angle. And again, I tend to drive them right into the ground. Reason being is I don't want to kick them and trip over them in the night. But they're a good angle, and that will take that'll need a hurricane to pull those out of the ground. So that's our tarp hung now. We've got our ridge line, we've got our prussic loops, we've got our stays, and the tarp's all pegged out. Next thing we'll do is hang our hammock. So my hammock of choice is the DD travel hammock. The reason I like those is that they're quite versatile. You can actually use the hammock as a bivy bag on the ground as well, because the bottom layer is waterproof. So you can use a bivy, you could just use it as a ground sheet and put your bedroll on top of that, but just erect the bug net so you've got protection from the insects during the night as well. And of course, it makes a great hammock. So, and that's what I'm rigging the DD, but the principles apply really with the others. Maybe you might need to make a few adjustments. So let's put up our tree huggers first, and I'll explain that. There's two types of tree hugger that I use. Is I use these DD's own tree hugger, and I'll just show you how to attach those to the tree, but also sometimes I use webbing as well, and that's a slightly different method. So I'll just show you through, I'll run you through both. First of all, we'll do the DD's own brand tree huggers. We'll put one of those on first. So with the DD tree hugger, is we take our hugger and put it round our tree, give it a hug. I think that's how the name arrived at. They arrived at that name. And again, let's wrap it round a couple of times, and then just, not tight, because you need to just adjust or centralise them. Okay. Now you'll notice you've got two loops there. OK,
Okay, now you can use, as DD do a, I think they call a soft toggle, which you can use, but I just use one of these carabiners and put it through both loops. So this attaches to both those loops, and that's our fixing for our whoopee sling, which I'll explain in a moment. So that's the DD hugger. Now on this form of tree hugger, I've this one I've made myself with a double overhand knot in the end to make a loop, and I've got about 2 meters of this. And the beauty of this is that obviously with the DD huggers you are limited onto the thickness of the tree that they'll wrap around. Obviously if the trunk's too thick there's not enough hugger to go all the way around, but with these you've got a little bit more flexibility on that score. But you do have to use these with the marlin spike and hitch, and I'll just run you through that now. So again, we give our tree a nice hug, pull our hug around, and then put this obviously through the loop. And that's it basically. So that's how we attach our hugger. Then what we do is we attach our toggle into this run of webbing, and that's what we attach our whoopee sling to. So I'll just show you the knot again for that. Again, I have shown it in another vid, but just for those that haven't seen that, I'll show it again. Okay, so there's our webbing hanger. So what we do is we go take our webbing round the fingers and then over the top of this section here, okay? And then just turn your fingers around like so, and then go over the top, pulling this section through that loop, and then inserting our toggle. So quickly, just once more. Round. Okay. Turn our fingers round like so, right over like that, and then pull this pit through and insert the toggle through that loop, and then pull like so, and there we are. And then I'll just show you briefly how we attach our whoopee sling to this marlin spike and hitch. So there's the loop of our whoopee sling. So we put that over that end of the toggle or spike, and then we might have to just pull that through a little bit so we can get the other bit over. And then what we do is we ensure that the whoopee sling goes behind this knot like so. It doesn't want to be on top of the stick like that, that's wrong, and that could slip or break. It needs to be behind the back of the knot there, like so. That's the correct way. Then just pull, obviously just centralize your toggle again, and that's how it should look. Okay, now with our DD tree hugger, it's just a simple case of attaching the loop of the whoopee sling into our carabiner, and that's attached. And I think that's how we'll attach the hammock in this instance. So we'll just do the other, put the hugger to the other tree. Obviously it's the same method at the other tree, and then we'll hang our hammock, and then I'll just run you through how I've rigged that. Now, as to the height of the tree hugger, you know, the height that you actually attach it to your tree, I normally find that you normally attach it kind of in line with your neck. Top of your shoulders in line with your neck. I personally find that that's the ideal height to hang them, and I have hung the tarp slightly lower just for demonstration purposes today, and normally it would be higher, so you know, it will give you plenty of clearance between the top of your hammock. But I find that height, that neck height, your hammock hangs at just the right degree. But I do appreciate that we're all different and we might do it slightly differently. But just running you through this will give you the basis, then you can make your own adjustments and or make your own mods and have it how you want it. But I find that that's the best height. I've been using hammocks now 10 years, actually more than that, about 12 years actually, and on and off, and through all of that I found that that's kind of the best time. So we'll attach the other end. Now this is exactly the problem that I was talking about a moment ago with the DD huggers. Not that there's anything wrong with them, they're perfectly adequate. But this is a thicker tree, and I try and go twice round, and he goes to there, I run out, you see, I run out of hugger. And I have used them like webbing before, by putting them through the loop once and then using them with a marlin spiking hitch. I've done that, and but they snapped on me, so I don't advise you to do that. And again, that's nothing, that's not the DD hugger's fault, that was my fault for not using them in the way that they recommend. But that's just a little tip so that you don't make the same mistake yourself. So what we'll do is we've got a DD tree hugger at that, on that tree, and this one we'll use the webbing hugger, which I've made up myself. And again, I've tested this over and over again, it is plenty strong enough. And this is the webbing I've used off of one of DD's, because I've got several of their hammocks. This was a excess webbing on one of the other hammocks that I've got of theirs, and I use this as for tree hugger, and it's plenty strong enough. It's been tested time and time again, and you'll see the benefit. You can go around the tree through the loop, and there's plenty there, you see. There we are again, like I say, neck height. Put our loop in over the top, put our toggle in, there we go. Then we're ready to hang our or attach our whoopee sling to that. So let's get the hammock hung. Now if you're not familiar with whoopee slings, you don't have to use these, but I really highly recommend them. They're very good because they're light, very, very strong. Apparently, they don't look it, you would think that that won't hold your weight, but it will. Apparently that can hold a car. So it's very good, but they will actually slide up and down on themselves, so you can make adjustments to your hammock. The benefit of that is if your hammock is not central between your trees, you would have to keep undoing your huggers and adjusting the marlin spike and making, you know, annoying adjustments. With a whoopee sling you can just slide one side, go to the other end, slide a bit more there and centralize your hammock, which is a great advantage. And although they slide up and down on themselves when they're slack or not under tension, when they're under tension, for example when you're in the hammock, they grip on themselves and they will not slip. I've never had one slip yet. So we'll attach that to our marlin spike and hitch. There we are, we take our whoopee sling loop over the top. Now the beauty of using the marlin spike and hitch is that when you want to strike camp in the morning, or whenever it is you do that, you just take off your whoopee sling, the toggle, just loosen at the back the knot, slide out your toggle, and then the knot just pulls out. Easy as that. Now as regard the actual hammock connections, normally with the DD hammock you'll have loads of this webbing. The reason they put that on there, I think, is so that you can attach it directly to the tree. And of course, you don't want to do that, because if it rains, your hammock, your sleeping bag, and you will get wet and cold. So I normally pull the webbing taut, an entire double overhand knot in the end, and I keep the excess webbing for huggers. Now, I would only recommend that you do that if you have a couple, you know, two or three hammocks, which I have. This is why I can do that. So I've always got one hammock where I don't do this, and I just tie a double overhand knot and leave the webbing on attached, and I just let it dangle. The reason I do that is that if I want to use that hammock as a bivy or a ground sheet with the bug net erected. But for the other two that I've got, I've cut the webbing off, double overhand knot, and then I use one of DD's ultra lightweight carabiners in there, like so, and that's how I attach the hammock end to the whoopee sling. So I'll just show you how to do that now. So there we go, we just take the other end of our whoopee sling, clip it in there, and then that's good to go. So we do the same the other end, and then we're ready to tension and centralise our hammock. Now, as you can see, I've just put the whoopee sling down there, the excess. As you can see, I've now got my carabiner attached to my whoopee sling and my whoopee sling attached to my tree hugger. And there we are. Ah, problem. This is incorrect. Two reasons. Firstly, our hammock is extending outside of our tarp and will get wet, and so is our water break. And the reason for this carabiner is not just for ease of attachment to our whoopee sling, but it also acts as a water break. And the fact that it's upside down means that water can track down your whoopee sling, because in a heavy shower or a heavy rain, water will pour down the trunk, because the branches of the tree are funneling the water into the trunk, obviously, so that water runs down the trunk and to the roots, so that to water the tree. And so water, and I've actually had this happen to me, and it's not pleasant. So water, in the case that it is in a heavy shower, as I say, and runs down the tree, it will wick down the tree hugger and down the across the whoopee sling. And if the carabiner's upside down, it will run down and then into your hammock webbing. Okay, it won't be as bad or severe if there was no carabiner, but it will stick. You will still get some. So what do? Well, simple. We unclip our tarp. Unclip our carabiner. Just loosen up our whoopee sling a little bit. And then what we do is we just turn it from that way, just turn it up the other way. That's the orientation that we want of our carabiner. Yeah. There we go. So we just attach that in the right orientation back onto our whoopee sling. And can you see the difference now? So now the water, if it does track down our whoopee sling, will run down there and drip off this point here. So that's fixed that problem. But again, we do need to adjust our whoopee sling so that this is underneath our tarp. So again, all we do is and this is the beauty with the whoopee slings, we just loosen off our whoopee sling, pull it tight. Ah, now we can see that our carabiner water break is underneath the tarp, and that's what we want, because if it's outside, rain could hit it and you could get some wicking. But now that it's inside, that hammock will now stay water tight, it will stay dry. So we do the same the other end. So we've adjusted our hammock hang, and as I've said before, because we have our tree huggers at neck height, we've now got quite a shallow curve to our hammock. And I find that you want to adjust the whoopee slings so that the initial height of your hammock is about belly button height. Okay? And then what I always do is just open it out remembering to take my knife off first, which I nearly didn't do. That's just another little tip, is I never ever wear my boots or knife or anything sharp in the hammock, because obviously it's under tension, and any sharp edge means it, because it's under tension, it will rip and tear very easily, or quickly could do. They are pretty tough, but even so, we don't want to take the chance. Now, again, you'll find that with the whoopee slings, there's no stretch at all, hardly, which is great. So you'll find that normally belly button height is sitting there, and just test it out, and I find that that's the ideal seating height, so that when you want to use your hammock for a chair, it's great, it's just the right height. And also, I find that with a shallow curve like that, it's the most comfortable, as you can see. If it's too much of a curve, there's too much sag in your hammock, then you're going to be like that, at that angle, and that's not going to be comfortable. I find the straighter you can be, the more comfortable the hammock is, especially if you lay across it slightly. Sometimes when I'm sleeping at night, I put my feet kind of one side of the hammock and my head on this side, so I lay across it just slightly. I'll do an exaggerated version of it now, but you can imagine if I'm laying across like that, because you can see my body's almost straight. So when I'm in the hammock, I find, yeah, in actual fact, I'm so comfortable now that I don't want to get out. But there we are. That's the hammock. That's the hammock height. Just one other thing as well. Your, where, you know, the end that you're going to sleep, your head end, that is, wants to be slightly lower than your foot end. And again, you can use the whoopee slings to adjust that. So for example, if my head is going to be that end of the hammock, then I'll adjust my foot end so that it's slightly more raised than this head end. The reason being, it just makes it slightly more comfortable. So that's the hammock hung. Now I'll just demonstrate how I peg out or suspend the bug netting. So I take, just lift the bug net, and you'll see that you will have your shock cord attached to the middle tab. But on top of your bug netting, this is on the DD hammock, it might be different on other hammocks, but you'll have a sleeve where you can attach your fiberglass spreader bars. But I don't tend to use those, reason being they take a lot of time and it's a bit fussy. So all I do is I take a thinnish stick, that size of your pinky, and then measure between the two end tabs so that they're taut. Just put my thumb there, and then I'll just saw that at a slight angle, make one the same length for the other end, and then I just insert those. I'll show you how I'll do that in a moment, and they just keep the bug net nice and spread apart. So I'll just cut these, and then I'll show you how I put them in. So there we are, I've cut myself the spreader bars, and you'll notice that I've cut them at an angle. Now the reason being is that when I insert them into the tab of the bug netting, you can put them in at so that the tabs are at an angle, and it helps them to grip. And then again, same the other end, cut at an angle, and we just open up that end tab. Don't worry about putting it through the middle one. There's absolutely no need to do that at all. So there we are, you can see that they're in the two end tabs. The middle one, all I use the middle tab for is just to keep the shock cord in. And that's all you need to do. That will keep the bug net in. So I'll do the same the other end. So with our spreader bars inserted into the tabs, what we can do now is we can take our shock cord, which is attached and threaded through our middle tab, and then we can pull our shock cord, and we can either attach it sometimes what I do is I attach it to the toggle on the prusik loop that's on the ridge line, and that keeps it erect. But if you're worried about rain, because theoretically you could get some tracking of water down here, it should stop at the toggle. But if that's a worry, and it can be, all I do is I attach them, I just tie a little slip knot in it and attach them to my carabiners. Now, although the bug netting's a little low, when you actually sit in it and sleep in it, because the hammock lowers, then the bug netting is raised higher, like so, as you can see there. What I'll do is I'll just tie a little knot in that. Because I'm using a 3x3 tarp, it's the shock cord is measured for a 4 meter. We'll just put a little bow in there. There we go. So as you can see there, I've attached that now to the toggle of the ridge line, and it raises that bug net like so. And there we are. So we just try the hammock out now. And there we are. So that's our hammock all ready to go. And like I say, you can see that the bug netting is nice, and it's got a nice shape to it. It's nice and open once you get in. And just attaching these shock cords up and to the toggle on the ridge line does the trick. You shouldn't get any wicking of water down those, because there's not a lot of it's paracord, so it's very thin. But as I say, if it is a worry and you are concerned about that, then it's a case of just take them, slip your shock cord, slip it off of the toggle on the prusik loop of the ridge line, and then just reattach it to your carabiner. And as I say, it is low to begin with, but once you lay in your hammock and your weights on it, then that does lift. That does lift the bug net. There we go. So we're almost done. And it's just one last thing really to add to is, if you're winter camping in a hammock, you will need, even in the summer really, you will need to put, or it's highly advisable to put, some kind of thermal insulation in the bottom of your hammock. Good thing about the travel hammocks, the DD travel hammock, is you've got these two layers where you can insert a mat between. Or some prefer the underquilts. I'm not yet an underquilt person, but that's not to say I won't be in the future. But at the moment, I just prefer, particularly in the English climate, it doesn't get so cold that a mat isn't sufficient. I just prefer, a pure and simple one of these roll mats, these foam roll mats, a self-inflating mattress in those two layers. I find that does me perfectly fine, but I could be proved wrong at some point. I'm willing to accept that, but again, that's just an addition. But basically, that's our hammock hang. So there we are. One other thing, folks, you may be wondering what this is. Most of you will realise, I understand that. This is one of DD's snake skins, and you have two cinch cords in either end, but you can use that when you finish with your hammock. You just pull that down like a snake skin or a sausage skin over the hammock, so it's ready for the next time you use it. Keeps it neat and tidy, stowed away in its stuff sack, but also it's waterproof. And so if you have to lay your hammock on the ground, which you invariably do, either when you're setting it up or packing it away, it keeps the hammock clean and dry. So it's worth getting one of these, in my opinion, to add to your setup. So there we are. Well, there we are, folks. I've tried my best to run through that in every detail that I can think. If I've forgotten anything, then just leave a comment below, and I'll do my best to answer it for you. But that's the way that I suspend my tarp and my hammock. I've tried various ways. That's the way I find helps. Like I say, this is not the only way. It's not written in stone. You may have other ideas, but I find that this really, if you follow this method, it will act as your basis. Then you can make your own little adjustments, your own little mods, as I said earlier, to just tailor it to suit the way that you want to sleep in the hammock. But if you've not slept in a hammock and you've not tried this, and you've just bought a hammock or you're thinking of buying a hammock and tarp set up, then hopefully this will help you guys. As I say, for many it'll be bread and butter, but for those that are a little bit unsure, then hopefully you'll find this helpful. So thanks guys, thanks for watching, and as I say, I hope it's helpful. Thanks for your continuing support of my channel and your vids and your views and comments. They're most appreciated, I assure you. And as I said before, I like to watch your vids as well, so it's that's great, particularly on days when you can't get out. So all that's left for me to say now really is thanks guys, and see you in the next video.